That's true.
Well, everyone, we're going to get started and welcome to our virtual Grand Round series. My name is Mickey Goodwin, Associate Dean for Clinical Practice, and I'll be introducing our special guest today. My co-hosts are Dr. Diana Baptiste, Katie Damaroda from Alumni Relations, and Dr. Rebecca Wright. First, just a few logistics. The session is being recorded. To receive a CNE unit, you must remain on the entire session and respond to an evaluation via email at the end. Questions or comments may be entered into the chat box and we will monitor them and address them at the end of the presentation. Our special guest today is Dr. Nancy Glass. Dr. Glass is the Associate Director of Johns Hopkins Center for Global Health and holds the Independence Chair in Nursing. Dr. Glass collaborates with global experts around the world to implement and evaluate innovative primary prevention programs that challenge social norms that sustain violence against women in humanitarian settings around the world. She examines the prevalence of gender-based violence in displaced refugee populations and leads innovative programs to improve health, safety, and economic stability for women, families, and communities. Today, Dr. Glass will address how the COVID-19 pandemic has served as a magnifier of health and gender inequalities globally. She will discuss how the global crisis provides an opportunity to do things we did not think possible by focusing on transformation change in research and practice through changes in structure, norms, and leadership. With no further ado, I'm very happy to introduce Dr. Nancy Glass.
Thank you, Dr. Goodwin. It's first just a pleasure to be here, and thank you to my colleagues for inviting me. And also I should say congratulations to the incoming cohort who was just inducted into Sigma for the new beta chapter. So what a great honor. So I'm going to share my screen because I'm an academician and I have to have a PowerPoint to speak from. I'm just going to start by, I've been spending, as many of you have, a lot of time alone thinking about, I think this has been a time that for many of you, us, we haven't been off doing our normal work, and not being able to travel has been a real sort of shock to my system. And so it's given me plenty of time to reevaluate and think what's the next, once we come out, how do we come out stronger? And how do I use what I've learned over the last year and a half to improve my research and really expand my thinking about how to engage in gender and health equity. So the thing I've been thinking about a lot is that term we've heard a lot is never let a crisis go to waste. And I think, interestingly, a lot of people see this as coming from a calculating and opportunistic sort of background. I tried to find out who originally said, never let a crisis go to waste. People attribute it to Churchill at the end of World War II, but then other people say he never said anything like that. And then people have been attributed to most recently to Rahm Emanuel, and who was the mayor of Chicago, and talking about how to respond to economic crisis and come back better. And so I started to look at what did I mean by sort of this calculating and opportunistic sort of focus. And many of you heard about what happened in Philadelphia. Which is the Philly Fighting COVID group that came together. And it was just a 22-year-old who convinced everybody that he had the plan through the startup to make sure vaccines would be delivered throughout Philadelphia and make sure that they would be delivered in an equitable way across populations and across communities. And so he used this kind of language of, you know, shooting for the heavens type of thing. We're going to have a preemptive strike on vaccines and basically beat everybody in Philadelphia to do it. Does anybody know what that means? But it absolutely sounded great to the tune of the mayor signing a contract for $2.7 million. And right before they started their vaccine work, they all of a sudden switched to a for-profit company. And they actually were, it was found out very quickly that they weren't able to deliver logistically, and that they were actually not getting people to the clinics, and the founder was taking vaccines home and vaccinating his friends. So needless to say, they did cut that contract. But what was so interesting is that there was a system to deliver vaccines. There was a network of clinics, there was a network of hospitals, and none of that was reached out to, because we wanted the new good thing. And so there are always people that are opportunistic and calculating. And so how do we then think about never letting a crisis go to waste, but doing it from an opportunity to do things differently, not as a startup, but do things that we thought we could not do. And so the questions I start to ask myself is really about my research and practice was, how does this crisis fit within my overall research mission, my purpose, my goals? And I think we can talk about this within the School of Nursing. How does the crisis fit within our School of Nursing mission and purpose? And then if we act according to our values, what would we do? And so if I'm acting on my my values, how would I change my research? What would I expand to do? What would I do differently? So it's no secret that I look at gender-based violence, and that's, I often say that's the only thing I know. And so when I'm talking about gender here and this today, is I'm purposefully talking about the hierarchical of power, the power imbalances in our society between what we define as men and women, and masculine and feminine. And so how these gender norms are, they're male and masculine is oftentimes strong, protective, and assertive. And it's favored over female characteristics are feminine, where we're caregivers, we're often seen as weak or too emotional. How many times have we heard about a politician that she'll be too emotional in times of crisis? And then we've also know that there's a systemic inequality that undermines the rights of women and restricts opportunities. But again, not just for women, but also for men and gender minorities to express themselves. By these rigid gender norms, we're often restricted to be who we really are, to fit into the norms, because we know that there are sanctions if our behavior is outside those norms in many cases. And when I talk about this, I'm talking from a global perspective where, I'm talking from 50% of the world's population are female in all its diversity. So I'm talking about the way that women experience inequity in their rights and opportunities. And gender inequality, we know, leads to inequities in health. And I'm going to just mention three issues that I really focus on a lot is reproductive health, partner violence, and then livelihoods, and how those are interconnected as we talk through this presentation. And I do want to acknowledge that I recognize that gender is neither binary nor fixed, and that this pandemic has differentially affects non-binary and transgender people, and that gender and global health intersects with ethnicity, race, religion, disability, and class. And this is very important, and there's been a lot more attention to intersectionality and the work that was done around acknowledging how gender and health do not operate in vacuums. These are complex social structures and systems. Oops. And then, so just to make sure we're all on the same page with health and health equity, and what I'm saying here is, and I think we all agree that everyone has a fair and just opportunity to be as healthy as possible. But we know the barriers, and the barriers are poverty, certainly racism, discrimination, And this deep power imbalance that is really deep within our social system. And the consequences are many, and they overlap. And they have been magnified through this pandemic of limited access to good jobs with fair and equal pay. When we're celebrating a $15 minimum wage, I'm very happy about that, but that is still just not enough money to live off of. Limited access to quality education and healthcare, housing insecurity, and unhealthy environments. These are the consequences in our global community. And just one sort of very classic example of how gender and health are really linked in this discussion is, so I always think of the sexual double standard. And this I experience a lot in my work around social norms and gender norms in humanitarian settings, where this notion is that these gender norms that endorse sexual freedom for men, sort of this sowing his wild oats, we've all heard that boys will be boys and that having as many sexual partners as possible is sort of a good thing because once they get it out of their system, then they'll be monogamous. And then the sexual restraint of women, the purity test. And so this sexual double standard certainly influences health. It influences health for men because if men are having unprotected sex with multiple partners, they're certainly at risk for sexually transmitted infections. But also the psychological impact of being told that that is the norm and that if you are not holding up to that norm, there is something wrong with you. And then certainly the health risk for women. And where I work a lot of times, we talk about the restriction in movement. When we see, and Andrew Crawley, my PhD student, did a really nice study on this, looking at data from DRC. He looked at how parents' endorsement of gender norms, and in this case, restriction of movement after puberty or around puberty for their daughters as a way to protect them from sexual risk factors and having sex outside of marriage, they are no longer allowed to play outside the home. Their restriction in movement, that restricts their opportunities to engage with peers, to learn new things, to participate in programs. And so we see that's sort of purity test restricts women's movements and girls' movements in many countries. In Somalia, where I worked, we often did our care for women in the clinic because that was the only place she could go that she was not accompanied by a male relative. So there's a lot of restrictions to to keep this family dignity and honor and the woman's purity. And so these health effects are certainly across the life course, and they reach far beyond just sexual and reproductive health. So as I said, this crisis has been a great magnifier for gender and health inequity in our society, in the US certainly, and globally. We have seen, and we knew this every day as public health folks, and working as nurses, that there was an inadequate investment in the local, national, and global public health system. And we now at Hopkins have had to build or have decided to build a parallel system to provide vaccinations because there was no system set up to really reach out into the mobile, to go mobile into senior high rises, into public housing, into the places where people are. So now we're setting up a system to do all of this. And that's because of the lack of investment in our public health system. And that there really is no safety net. The amount of effort that we had to put in to get $1,400 stimulus checks to our citizens most recently is amazing. And there's a lack of political will to aid those most in need. We still have that notion of pull yourself up by the bootstraps, that it's your fault you're living in poverty, and so we have seen the closing of safe houses, closing of shelters, the burden on the food banks, where we see long lines. I know we've all seen the long lines, and the health clinics, and not having enough equipment, not having you know, just what we define as essential, where we not, we women are no longer allowed to get contraception. You know, they aren't able to get their appointments. What does that, how does that affect their lives and their long-term, the next years of their life by not having able to get their Depro shot, for example, because the clinic is closed, and not making any accommodations or recognizing that early enough to make the accommodations. And then the gross inequities in which we value women in our global society, and certainly women, we see provide the scaffolds of our survival in the home. Women work as family caregivers in the function of the household and the work in the front line. We certainly know women in the front line of healthcare provision globally, this, you know, looking globally, but those who are also at the market selling the groceries and caring for our children in the home and outside the home. So this is focused on the sustainable development goals, and certainly gender equality is goal number 5. And this sort of looks at before COVID-19, and I have great agreement that we have made a lot of improvements in gender equality globally in the US, but these targets have remained unreached. And the areas that we've made a lot of movement, and what we're working on in Ethiopia, for example, is reducing early marriage, so child marriage. But as we've seen with the conflicts in Ethiopia now, and in the refugee situation where people remain coming into Ethiopia from South Sudan and from Somalia and other countries, that we're starting to see a rise in early marriage and child marriage in these countries because of certainly the other aspect, conflict plus COVID-19 and the reduction of resources to these communities, isolation in these communities. And so certainly we've also seen an increase in violence against women. So if your child can bring, your girl child can bring in a dowry for the family, this doesn't mean that you are horrible parents, but you are trying to survive. So you may marry your child earlier for the survival of your family. And so we've also seen in women with, in the representation globally of women in leadership in the pandemic. And what we see still is, I mean, about 25% of national parliaments are made up of women, and 36% in local governments. So we're still quite a bit below 50% in equal participation in the policy development that so impact our lives. And then what we know, and I'll talk a little bit about this, and which has been the central focus of mine and colleagues, is looking at how the lockdown has increased the risk for partner violence and violence against women and girls and children, the boy child as well. And we've seen that cases of domestic violence have increased by 30% in some countries. And again, a lot of this is anecdotal data where we're looking at calls for police assistance, we're looking at hotline calls. But in many countries, nothing has been done to really invest in the systems to prevent and respond to gender-based violence. And so we have very little data to really, a lot of this is what we know about the research, that this is the perfect storm for an increase in violence. Isolation in the home, financial stress related to loss of work or income, children not being in school, coping using alcohol and other drugs, all of these are increase the risk for partner violence. And then we also know, as I said earlier, women are on the front line of fighting the parental violence. And globally, women account for about 70% of health and social workers. And we also know that women bear additional household burdens during the pandemic. They're the care providers. If a family member is ill, if you have older parents that you're caring for, as well as children that you're caring for in the home, now you're also becoming educators as you homeschool your children, and also trying to manage the impact, the psychological impact and the loss for the family members, but also the burden on our children around not having the social engagement that they're used to and need. So let me just give you an example. I found this research so interesting, and this is some work that's been done by CARE International. When we look at women's representation in the COVID national response teams, it's quite shocking. Where the highest we got to was in Canada, which was slightly over 50% representation of women on the team. But look at the US, below 10%. And so when I start to ask myself, who's there representing the burden that women and girls are experiencing during this pandemic in the US and globally, I don't see a lot of people that may have my experiences or similar experiences that I am sure are thinking about the issues that impact 50% of the population's life. So that has really, you know, irked me. And there's no reason, because we know there are plenty of women in this country that would be excellent at serving on these as representatives on these commissions and making decisions. And how does this, then if you look again by CARE, how does this result in our gendered responses? So we talked about gender-based violence response. The check means that yes, there've been policies and government support that has targeted these areas. And you can see many countries have, but as you look at the US, we have not had funding that has been targeted at a national level to gender-based violence, even though we know that there's been an increased burden on the system to respond with no more resources. Then we look at sexual and reproductive health care responses. And this includes access to contraception. This includes access to safe abortion. And we see again that in the US, women, this has not been addressed. You know, why when women go in, when we go in to get our shots, our COVID shots, why don't we have a system where we can talk to women about contraception? I mean, it would make sense to me, especially in this time where, you know, there's a lot of stress in people's lives, and an unplanned pregnancy can be a very stressful event in a family's lives. And so you see childcare support. Yes, we have improved some funding for childcare support and support that mitigate the economic effect on women. Certainly we've had some focused programs around childcare and around the stimulus package. And certainly what we're seeing most recently with the CARES Act and the new legislation that's passed, there's quite a bit of hope about how this will impact and help to equal the playing field a little bit. I don't know if people have heard about the book by Heather McGee. She wrote with Some of Us, and it's about how racism not only impacts Black communities, but it also impacts all of the community. And one of the great examples she provides in the book is the swimming pool example, where in the US for much of the first half of the 1900s, one of the great things the community, local community government did was build swimming pools so that everybody had access to swimming pool regardless of class, unless you were African American. Then you did not have access to, it was a segregated swimming pool. And when integration occurred in many communities, instead of allowing access to African Americans, communities filled in the swimming pool with cement. And in my hometown, I can go visit that swimming pool that was filled in. And now there's a sign there that acknowledges that's what my community leaders decided to do rather than integrate the swimming pool. So that's when we started to get to private clubs, whites only clubs. But before everybody could have, if we had allowed integration, everybody would have benefited from the swimming pool. It would have been for the whole community. They closed it down, everybody loses. Certainly the target is African-Americans. They're the first to lose, but everybody in the community loses in that. And so that's what we also see I'm losing my train of thought, but That's what I've also seen with many of these policies, that that now what we're seeing now with the newest legislation. Heather McGee, when I was listening to one of her interviews, who wrote this book, she said this is an opportunity to fill the swimming pool back up and allow people to benefit as a community again, that we'll all benefit if we pass safety net legislation. So that was the important analogy, I think, that was really resonated for me, because I remember them filling the swimming pool. And so as the work I'm doing is certainly in partner violence, and one of the things that we've been thinking about is, you know, how do these stay-at-home orders allow an abusive partner to exert more power and control, and restrict movement and limit relationships and, you know, with family members or friends, and also refusing to purchase just basic needs for the family. The other thing we've heard about is sharing misinformation about the virus to create fear, so that she will not reach out for help or go to the shelter or go for safety or even get a vaccine. And so preventing access to health services. So these are things specific to the virus that, you know, we had not thought about in controlling behavior, but things that women are starting to tell us. And then certainly reaching out to get help has become a real challenge, because how do you do that when you're afraid for your children's health, for your health, and then who else could you put at risk in your family if you are exposed to the virus by seeking help in shelters and then coming home and putting others at risk? And really just that lack of opportunity to have contact with partner, with someone outside your home, when your partner's monitoring your telephone or your use of the internet so closely now that you're sheltered in place. And then we saw necessarily the closure of many in-person services. We saw the closures of shelters, clinics, and treatment programs. But as a society, you know, how do we now prepare ourselves when we have the next epidemic to not have to shut everything down for these safety net services, so we can protect the people working in these settings, but also provide really what is essential services, and making sure that we define essential services from a gendered response. So I'm with the Building Back Better. I think that's really what we're talking about. How do we, in our role as nurses and advocates and leaders, how do we value the role and the voices of women and other undervalued in our communities? And so I've been thinking a lot about transformative change. And what I mean by that is reshaping this power imbalance by stepping up and then stepping into the crisis. And I have to say, I think the School of Nursing has done this incredibly well. There, you know, we have not retreated. We have our, you know, I've been doing vaccines with the nursing students, and they have a lottery to get out there to do vaccines. I mean, that these folks, and when they're out there, they're just amazing. And so people want to step in and be helpful. And so I'm really thinking of this as a process in which we can assert our rights to be part of the decision-making, to be part of the solutions. And by really, you know, evaluating our experiences, our relevant experiences, questioning their roles in society, the norms and the roles that we've been given in society, and then challenging these power structures really for social change. And I think what we do well, and what I've seen colleagues do really well, is lead with empathy, that attention to the emotional dimensions of comfort and attention to those in need. So, you know, we understand the complexity of women's lives and underserved communities' lives, and then leading through that attention to the emotional dimension of, we know the loss in families, we understand the burden of not having children in the school, and how do we pay attention to that in our policies? And then lead with equity. So a constant attention to the economic impact and the importance of equitable responses to the crisis. And a great example is the equitable distribution of vaccines in the US. You know, we cannot continue. I mean, the convention center is a great opportunity. If you have a car, if you have somebody to drive you there, but many people don't have access to transportation, or it's expensive. And even getting on a bus, it just doesn't feel safe to many people because of the virus. And also mobility issues. I mean, when I'm in the senior housing doing vaccines with the students, I think to myself frequently, how in the world would this resident get to the convention center? It's just not possible. It's not a hesitancy to get the vaccine, because I'm telling you, they're there getting the vaccine. It is just the burden to try to get there. So we've got to challenge the systems. And I think we're doing that to take the vaccines where they need to be. And we know we need to go. There's a nurse, I can't remember where, maybe in Ohio, that takes the every day after the end of the clinic, takes the extra shots and goes door to door in the neighborhood to deliver the vaccines. And I think we've got to get to that point to make sure that we're having an equal distribution. And the other thing that I think is really important is this is not a zero-sum game. And according to this premise, this is really from economic development. If we give attention to one community or one issue, that does not mean it is at the expense of others. So women in leadership is not a zero-sum game. The gains by women in leadership is not at the expense of men. I'm not saying that men need to move aside and never be leaders. I'm saying let us sit beside you and help you and help make important decisions where we can bring our relevant experience and our style of leadership, which is as positive as being assertive. You can be assertive and empathetic and focus on equitable services. And I know you've been paying attention to this too, but I started to look at those countries that that did well, especially in the early times of COVID, with the number of cases and deaths. And when you start looking at a pattern, you start to see that they are women in leadership in those countries. When we think of New Zealand, Taiwan, Germany, Norway, Finland, Denmark, all female leaders of the country. And I know that cases have gone up and down in some of these countries, but we did see a very different response, especially early on. And the research that I looked at is primarily from the first quarter. And it really was explained by very proactive response policies. So really taking early proactive lockdowns and mandates, which we know that have been criticized greatly in this country. If you think about the state of Michigan and the governor of Michigan and how she has been targeted related to those early lockdown. And then the other thing that was noted in the review was empathy and attitudes towards risk. You know, there is that understanding that this is a sacrifice, these lockdowns are asking people to make a lot of sacrifices, and that empathy towards that, and then thinking about once the pandemic ends, how do we respond with services to help people regain their lives more quickly? And then I think which is incredibly important is decisive and clear communication. And I think the president of New Zealand, I think, would be a leader in this, and how she really was very clear in the protocols and the lockdown. And if you now look at New Zealand, they are living their lives. And I understand they're an island, and I understand they don't have the population, but they did something very right about the epidemic. So the solution in my mind, and the challenge, is not simply to add women to the existing structures to appease us, put me on the board of something, but to transform those structures to allow women meaningful participation in leadership, which I think can lead to gender and health equity. So the things that I've been thinking of and others, and what would transformational change look like? And so I think it's promoting, obviously, women's meaningful participation in decision-making from the local to the national level. And gender parity on these really complex issues and solutions that we want, because there is a gendered response to a pandemic. And this isn't the first pandemic that we've known this. We've seen it in Ebola. The work out of West Africa and DRC shows an increase in violence against women in these countries that had Ebola. And then we see a longer startup in the economy for women than men, how they get re-engaged into the economy. And work with local women-led and women's rights organizations. I mean, there's been a lack of investment globally in the women's rights organizations and women-led organizations. And often they, one of the biggest issues that we've seen in my area is that we want to work with women's rights groups. We want to collaborate, but many of them are closing down because there's no more funding really for operations. All of the funding is project specific. So everybody runs from project to project, and there's no more support to build the infrastructure and the organization, a women's led organization. And then, you know, that nurturing of the leadership to where they become a sustainable organization has become very difficult. So many women's groups are just moving from one project to another, and oftentimes just overwhelmed by trying to make the grant reports. Some of us may relate to just trying to make the grant reports, but that's how it feels now. And ensure that the frontline health and social service workers, and the majority globally are women, are represented at all levels of decision-making. If we're gonna put our lives on the line, which many, we should be able to have the conversation about what will the response look like, and then what will the recovery look like? Ensure the availability and accessibility of these key services. Really thinking about, as we're shutting down and as we're preparing to shut down, that there are going to be impacts on health and they are going to be gendered. And so we have to think about gender-based violence prevention and response, primary, emergency, and sexual and reproductive health care for women and girls, and facilitate access to populations in need of assistance so that we continue to provide resources to the most vulnerable in our community. And then advocate certainly for the inclusion and of age, disability, and sex disaggregated data in our country, as well regionally and locally, as we think about these strategies and response plans. That is one of the biggest barriers we have. We don't have access to data that really shows the impact that's happening for across the lifespan for disabled women and girls. And so we have to start demanding the data to help us really guide policymaking. And then I think, you know, we're all very committed to building relationships with local partners, but we have to make sure that there are ongoing mandatory consultations by our leadership, our politicians, with civil society, and that women leaders in all of these policies measures. You know, these are sort of the key things that I'd just like to leave you with.
Wow, I think you've left us with some very, very powerful messages, and I think that there will be a lot of comments. I'm hoping people will actually feel comfortable in unmuting themselves. If they don't want to use the chat box, you can unmute. I'll just quickly make one comment, which first of all, a couple of comments. The deep power imbalances you spoke about really struck me, and what specifically as nurses we can do. And it made me think of the men in nursing movement, actually, because we're one of the few professions that we have so many more females than males. And yet, by the numbers you showed, you know, we still need to up our representation. And I'm actually wondering if men in nursing could help us, you know, affect policy development as nurses in the community, and, you know, just making, I don't know, if maybe there's a roundabout way that making men in nursing help females in nursing. Well, what do you think, Nancy?
Well, you know, I think that my experience with men in nursing has always been very positive. You know, I have very competent and capable colleagues that really advocate for nursing, the profession. And I've never felt as if, you know, I haven't felt any challenges in that situation. But again, we don't have as much interaction with men in the profession. But what we do know is when men are in the profession, they advance more rapidly to leadership. And you know, I think that we as women have to recognize our own biases in who's a good leader, right? I think we've had this conversation oftentimes in student government, and oftentimes in nursing students, I mean nursing schools, even though the vast majority of students are women, we often see the president of the class as a male, or in leadership roles. And I think that that's one thing that we have to also, you know, the norms that I grew up with certainly are that I saw more male leaders. I saw, you know, basically that's all I've seen in leadership in the country and political leaders. And, you know, we often talk in my household, this amazing change of who are journalists now and who's presenting the news to us. I mean, when I don't know, but I'm probably, many of us are older, we all know, but Walter Cronkite was it. I didn't know that there was anybody else that did news, and certainly not a woman of color doing news. And so we're seeing all these young people and young and diverse. Sometimes I just stop and I just look and I'm like, did you look at all these women, young women on TV? And so I think, you know, now younger people are seeing it differently. They see leadership differently. But I still have those very fixed, and I'm changing the norms that we were, you know, what our roles were. And so I think we also have to challenge ourselves, like who do we see as the leaders? And one of the important things we see in gender-based violence globally is in many countries, when we do the DHS survey and we ask women if it's acceptable to abuse if it's acceptable for a man to abuse his wife, if, for example, she burns the meal, more women than men endorse that. So the norm is very strong that you know, there are good reasons for men to discipline their wives, because that's what they saw in their household, that's how their mother taught them, it's the norm. And so I think we have to recognize that we have to challenge our norms and how we present them.
Wow. Well, I think the book you talked about, the Heather McGee book, The Sum of Us, would be good reading for all of us, you know.
It's a brilliant, one of the most important books that I've read in my time, really. This was really resonated with me of how effective policymakers are at creating fear, and how they use fear to control, and how that fear, we work against our own interest in many cases. And I thought she did a brilliant job of showing that. And she gives several cases of how that was done over the years. So
Hira Han has a Hand up.
Thank you. Nancy, thank you so much for your wonderful presentation. As someone who grew up in South Korea, where we have the strong, clear gender hierarchy, I completely can relate to your presentation in terms of what's happening around the globe. The situation is getting better, but still, like you said, there are a lot of policymakers at the national level who are male than female. Personally, I'd be curious to learn a bit more about your research, because your research, based on my understanding, even though I have little knowledge about gender-based violence research overall, but I believe that your research, the intervention approach in particular, is really tapping on this idea of empowering women and adolescent girls. Mm-hmm. So I'd be curious to learn a bit more about the particular research programs that you are spearheading for many years, and how that particular approach has been impacting these women and girls in terms of their own empowerment and leadership development. So I think this sort of goes beyond the general research realm as well. Thank you.
Thank you. So thanks, Hera. I've had an interesting evolution as in my research. You know, I started out very focused on the response to gender-based violence, sort of, you know, as a nurse, the healthcare response. So mostly after the violence had occurred, you know, how did we treat them when they came into the healthcare system? You know, how to build capacity to manage the health of a survivor, and then also in shelter systems, or developing, you know, really thinking about safety planning and what does safety planning mean, and does it really help women become more safe? But as I've gone along, and especially working globally, you know, the recognition that prevention is so important, primary prevention, if we're going to ever reduce the need for response, right? So that's when I've really been, over the last 5 or 6 years, focused more on primary prevention in combination with response programs. So especially in humanitarian settings, and when I first started doing primary prevention in humanitarian settings, I remember a colleague said to me, could you pick a more difficult context to try to do this work? And the reality is, it's actually probably the easier context in my experience, because when I'm working in a refugee setting, for example, or in even with urban settlements and displaced populations, you often have a UN response. So there's actually people that do provide gender-based violence services, where in the local community, in the host community, those services may or may not exist. We actually are trying, there's an infrastructure from child protection to WASH to all this infrastructure that's been built up in healthcare as well to support the refugee or displaced population. So that's one issue that you can then ethically go in and do research, because you have somebody to refer to. There's a system to refer to. But importantly is that when you've had such a change in the structure, like because of conflict, there's often a change in family structure and community structure. For example, women who have been displaced in Somalia or in refugee camps, they're often there as the head of household, where in the past they were not the head of household. And so they're taking on roles that they had not previously taken on, which could be you know, making decisions about finances, making a decision about education for their children. So it's actually a time where change is happening very rapidly, and that we then go in and talk with the leadership about what are the social norms, what are norms that are that exist that are sustaining violence against women. And what we have found, it's not unique to what we see in the US in many cases, but this thing of victim blaming, like blaming the victim for the violence. If she hadn't have gone out wearing that skirt, if she hadn't have been out after dark. And what was interesting is I had people saying this to me in Somalia, where women are completely covered. They shouldn't have been wearing that. And I'm like, so it's not what she's wearing. It's, but we can blame it on that, right? That's the excuse. And then also this dignity and honor for the family, that if people find out that she's been in a raped or in an abusive relationship, then that somehow will bring dishonor to the family. So, and then, similar other, working outside the home is not appropriate for a woman because she will be exposed to more men and that will tempt her, right? Or tempt the men. So these are some of the norms that are not unique to Somalia, they're all over. And so what we've been doing is having, and Nancy Perrin has worked with me on this, is having community dialogues about these norms and how do these norms develop and what do they mean? And so we have this 15-week program that men and women discuss these norms together. And then they decide, that how these norms can be harmful, and they decide about what are alternative norms? Because if you change a norm, you typically have to replace it with some other norm. And so the norm is that men don't get impunity for raping a woman, that there will be consequences. And so you start to demand the consequences, and then the response systems change. And believe it or not, we saw significant changes in Somalia and South Sudan over 3 years by doing these programs. And so it's really that combination of prevention and response. And at the same time, we have to challenge healthcare providers' norms too, because we all grew up in the society where we experience the same norms. So a healthcare provider or a nurse, we often would hear nurses say, well, she shouldn't have been there. That's why she got raped. So we have to work with healthcare providers as well on the response end to not also bring those harmful norms that prevent women from seeking services. So, and that goes back, all of this goes back to gender equity, it goes back to how we define norms, define roles in our society.
Thanks.
Sorry, that's very long-winded, but no, it's a long, complicated story.
Important conversation. I think Jane Sumner, Diana, you can help me out. I think Jane Sumner was next to the hand up.
Okay, I'm sorry. I was not able to see the hands up. Go ahead, Jane.
You need to unmute.
Can you hear me now? Yes, you should. Thank you, Dr. Glass. I really enjoyed that. I'm reading a book by Geraldine Brooks called Nine Parts Desire. And it's stories of Muslim women. And although you've talked a little bit about Ethiopia and Somalia, I've been wondering if you've done any sort of comparative studies related to religion. And for example, whether some of the Muslims are strictly following the Sharia law versus, a more relaxed, almost anything else. So I'm curious to know about that, but I'd just like to make one observation. I am a New Zealander by birth, and after the Muslim massacre in Christchurch, 2-3 years ago, a lot of those Muslim women had never driven a car. They didn't know how to balance their checkbook. They didn't know anything because the men did it. And so the community literally had to step up, all of the community, to help these women, drive them to a doctor's appointment, for example, help them get driver's education. Mm-hmm. And I think it was actually quite impressive what those New Zealanders in Christchurch did to assist those women. And I think you sort of alluded to that in what you have just said, actually.
Right. Well, I don't know very much about my experience of religion. But what I do know in my experience in working in Somalia and Ethiopia, and now I'm doing some work in Jordan and Northwest Syria, is that, violence is not a part of the religion. That is an excuse for why women are restricted, their movement is restricted, their exposure to the outside world is restricted. And it really comes down to controlling, in my, or, you know, her sexuality, her sexuality and her offspring, and how more than the religion. And so I just don't know about the religion. I think of it more as it's just the control, the power imbalances in the control. And I think that that religion is often used as a justification for really bad and harmful behaviors. And I see that in the Christian belief as well. And there's just a recent book, I forget what it's, the family. This woman just came out with a recent book just from the US, you know, about how religions start and they can become very controlling and isolating and once you can leave that, sort of how you interact with community, the society becomes very challenged because it hasn't been your experience. So I just don't know about the religion part.
In the interest of time, we actually have the screen as long as we want it, but I realize some people probably have to leave after an hour, and that's absolutely fine. You will still get your CNE. I know Bridget has a comment, and I think it would be great to hear her if you have time, Nancy, and we'll understand if anybody needs to leave at this point. I do want to thank you all very, very much. Bridget?
Yes, thank you, Mickey. Dr. Glass, excellent conversation. I'm just curious, for some of your women, the perspective on any crossover with sex trafficking. Mm-hmm. I'm not as familiar with it globally as I am domestically, but just knowing that 88% of women who have been trafficked, and young men, will have an encounter with a healthcare provider. And are you looking at any of that in your research, or do you see any crossover or not? Thank you.
Yeah, it's such an interesting complex topic on trafficking. The violence against women movement globally, I like to tease, there is a cabal. I mean, there are very powerful groups that believe very strongly that violence against women is very separate from violence against children, is very separate from trafficking. And so, and a lot of that comes from a scarcity model, where if there's not a lot of funding for any program, people are afraid to overlap because the funding will be taken away and given to trafficking instead of violence against women. So it's a very complex issue globally about how these programs interact and how people look at it across experiences, but absolutely. I mean, one thing, I mean, this is not exactly trafficking, but I've been working with the UNFPA in Myanmar right before the military coup, and right after. And we first started working looking at experiences of sex workers, and some of those women are trafficked from the surrounding communities. I mean, countries, and go there to be migrant workers, and then oftentimes are trafficked in sex work. And so we were working with UNFPA. They were doing a cash transfer, which is sort of a protection where you do a quick one-time $300 cash transfer to sex workers that they know through their HIV programming. And that because of the lockdown, their business has been down, they're not able to support their family. And most of the sex workers are mothers in most cases, or fathers. There are a few that are male. And And so it was having a great impact and stress on the families. And so we were seeing increased violence in the household, increased violence against the children. So what we saw is with that one-time cash transfer, we then followed them over time and asked questions. And we did see an improvement in food insecurity and being able to, childcare and being able to get back to work. And I know for many people, they're like, oh, sex work, that is work for many women, because actually most of these women have jobs and this is sex work supplements their income because they're supporting the family, the whole family. And so they lost their regular job. So they had to do more sex work. So it's very complicated in these communities, especially in Myanmar where sex work is illegal. So then they're very concerned about police and police violence. And that's the thing we see here too, is a lot of violence by the police and a lot of challenges for sex workers. So even getting to a clinic, usually the clinics that they're attached to are related to HIV. And as one woman told me here, a transgender woman that we were working with, she's like, the only services we can get is HIV. If we, housing, job support, job training is almost closed to us. It's really focused on just sexuality and sex for many of the services. So I think that that's a big issue as well. It's how we provide the range of services to a transgender community and to sex work. And I don't want to conflate those. Those aren't necessarily the same thing, but just how we limited services and how we discriminate against those populations.
Thanks, Nancy. And this is being recorded. I know that Bridget had to run off to teach.
Oh, sorry, Bridget.
I think we'll take one more hands up from Serena, and then we'll wrap this up. Thank you. Go ahead, Serena.
I'm muted, sorry. Thank you so much, Nancy, for this wonderful presentation. I know as someone coming originally from West Africa, Liberia, which is a post-war country, I can definitely relate to a lot of what you presented. But I also know that, as we seek, to decrease violence against women in those countries and promote the women, equity for women, there's a lot of opposition of politicians there. So I'm just curious, in your work, what has been some of the best practice in trying to win over these politicians? Because they're the leaders, they're the political leaders, they have the power. Some of them are actually the perpetrators of, the violence against women, the sex trafficking. So, what have you learned? What has been your best practice in dealing with these politicians and getting their support to promote, promote your work?
My strategy is to get more women elected. I have just found it extraordinarily difficult to change the hearts and souls of some of these politicians and the way they view women. I mean, many of the politicians that are as outspoken as they are have quite benefited from women not challenging them and the norms. They're quite successful in the way things are, and changing that is not of interest to them. And they do see it as zero-sum game. They see it if more women come aboard, then that men will have to leave. They don't see it as working collaboratively. So I think we have to do what women have done for centuries, is organize and keep. And what we have shown in the 2018 election and recently is the amazing young women who are leaders that we need to get out there, because I really just don't see that some of the leaders that are there are going to change, because it does not benefit their pocketbook in many ways. And so I encourage you to run for office. That's what I encourage you to do.
Okay, I hear you. Thank you.
Well, I think that brings us to a very good close. I'm extremely grateful to you, Nancy, for a really eye-opening presentation. I think you've given us all a lot of food for thought, some great books to read, and I'm sure this is not the end of this conversation, but the beginning of a lot more. So thank you very, very much. Thank you to all who attended, and please be sure to do the evaluation when it gets sent to you. And this will close today's session. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Goodwin. Thanks, Dr. Glass. Wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you.